Hey guys, this is Dave from Nerdarchy for Nerds by Nerds. Getting ready to play some 5th edition Dungeons & Dragons with these nerds. So if you guys just want to go through real quick, introduce yourself and your character, and then we'll get this shindig started.
Hi, I'm Aaron. I'm going to play a human fighter named Tearsmat.
Alan?
Hi, my name's Alan. I'm going to be playing a warlock, Arakoa, named Uncle Sam.
And Bert?
Hi there, my name's Bert, and I am playing Anvil, the Dwarven Cleric.
And my name is Bill. I will be playing Thump, Half-Orc, level 5 Barbarian, level 3 Fighter.
Awesome. So, all four of you's all four of you find yourself in the Cauldron. It is the nickname that is given to the city of Fausthaven because it lies within a valley where there is these natural hot springs and steam vents from deep within the earth that the residents have been able to tap into, and it makes the city of Fausthaven much warmer than the surrounding climates because it's almost temperate to Arctic region, but in this area it is always warm. But also because of the residents' ability to tap into those vents, they've also developed a little bit of technology. So it is slightly steampunkish in nature in this area, and there is always factories and machines billowing smog and smoke into the air. So it is also always very overcast here. The NAG is an organization of mercenaries that do the best that they can, and for the most part, they always try to fight for just causes and for the little guy. You are all members of the NAG, and it is early in the morning. Some of you guys are either, you know, finishing up a really late night, or you're an early riser and getting started early. And already, it is a scorcher of the day, here in the Cauldron. You guys find yourself at the NAG headquarters. At any given time, you can find any number of hard-bitten men and women lounging about or looking for work. The common room is large and open, with a hot breeze being circulated by rickety fans above. It serves as a lounge, reception area, and tavern. In the back, there is a training hall, both indoors and out, for recruits to hone their skills. Upstairs, some private rooms for rent, as well as the barracks for those of lesser means. All benefits of being a company man. Things have been quiet for months now, with jobs far and few between, and coin might even be running a bit low at this point. As the four of you are either coming in the middle of coming or going, or even just lounging about, it so happens that the shift sergeant comes storming through the office with a rolled up piece of parchment clutched in his fist. He reads off each of your names as he walks through. It's your lucky day, fellas. You have a job. He beckons you to the back offices where they generally meet, and they call them the war rooms. This is where you'll receive the details of the latest job.
I'll get up and follow him.
I kind of sling my weapon and go, okay, whatever.
All right. So the shift sergeant just went through. He's a gentleman that goes by the name of Jurgen. Easily 60 winters in age, salt and pepper hair. Trim physique, average height, stands ramrod straight. His persona just screams military, and he looks good for his age. When he speaks, his voice is gravelly, befitting of a dwarf, actually, like stone on stone. We've been called by a local business. Moondarks. They want us to show up. They're paying well. And they got a job for us. this guy wants this job done bad. He wants it done quiet. He's a horned bastard by the name of Jacob Moondarks. Moondark Associates is a banker here in town. Apparently he's got a problem with pests he needs dealt with. Badly enough, he's willing to pay 1,000 gold pieces. And of course, as usually, the nag gets us customary 15%. They'll have the details on location for you.
Okay.
With that, he slaps down a piece of paper, the piece of parchment he's been carrying around on the desk, and it's got the address and the name of Jacob Moondarks and Associates on there. Why are you still here? Get
it. I'll grab the paper and head for the front door.
I'll kind of jog after him.
Okay, it's early in the day. Traffic is just starting to pick up on the streets. People slogging off to work. You can see there, you know, many of them still have sleep in their eyes and aren't very enthusiastic about the day. But the crowds are still fairly light. You know, it's only like 15 minutes walk to Jacob Moondark's place here in the center of town. It's not very far from the headquarters. It's a nondescript stone building. Windows outside, front porch is well kept. There's even some plants and some greenery, which is kind of rare. Shows that he probably has a little more wealth than the normal citizen here in Fausthaven.
Well, if he runs a bank, I would hope so.
You know, there's a bronze plaque, you know, outside the door denoting what this place is. Bold letters, Jacob Moondarks and Associates.
Okay, we're here. I'm going to enter in.
All right, as you enter in, a bell chimes above the door. And it's the antechamber to the building. It's a small waiting room. There's a couple of chairs and a bench, and there's one door, you know, leading out of this room, and off to the right hand side, you have a it's not quite a desk. It's not quite a counting in between, and as you come in and you look over, you hear shuffling behind it. At first, you don't actually see anybody, but what you do eventually see is a knot of hair or messy bun, kind of like bobbing up and down just above the top of the counter. And it, as it moves further along, it gets it rises higher up till eventually you can see the forehead and then the head. And then the shoulders and chest of a young woman who's clearly standing on something and is of halfling descent, chestnut brown hair, which she has a ton of it, most of which has been piled up onto the top of her head with two pieces of scorched wood shoved through it, holding it into place. She's wearing a small pair of wire framed spectacles that make her green eyes appear even larger than they are. She has a kind smile and cherub cheeks. And as she takes stock of the four of you, she asks, "What can she do for you, gentlemen?"
"We're here to see Mr. Moondark."
"Do you have an appointment, sir?"
"No, but he's expecting this."
I see. Who shall I tell him's calling?"
"I'm curious, Mag. Of Nag."
Excellent. That's when she pulls out what looks like almost like a cup, or even like the bell or a bell, and she holds it up to her mouth and talks softly into it. "The Nagsmen, they're here for you. I'm sending them back." And then she puts it back down behind the desk. And she says, right through that door, gentlemen. Straight through, past the stairs, there will be a large oaken door on your right. You can enter there.
Thank you. And I head for the door.
We'll proceed that direction.
So, as you head through the door and down the hall, you easily follow her directions and find where you're going. And again, this door also has a plaque on it. It says Jacob Moondarts. It's bronze. It's nice. The door is. It looks like it's been oiled and polished recently. And as you just get to the door, it opens of its own accord. And in a large plush room with shelves lined filled with books, on two of the four walls, there's a huge hearth on the other one. There's a large, enormous oaken desk at the far end of the room, with a man standing or sitting behind it, sitting up ramrod straight. And you quickly recognize him for what he is, and his heritage. He's a tiefling, which is quite clear by his dark skin, ram-like horns. He's got a little bit of an overbite with pointed canines. And he's also dressed really, really well in a suit. And he beckons you to come in and have a seat and join him.
I enter. Tell him I prefer to stand. It's hard to get up in plate mail.
I also enter and stand next to Aaron in plate. Aaron, what was your character's name?
Terrace Matt.
Stand next to Terrace Matt. Flexing my wings, I point out the same thing. It's difficult for me to sit in human chairs.
As you will. However is most comfortable for you. We have very little time, and matters are pressing.
Okay.
As you already know, my name is Jacob, and if you would be so kind as to introduce yourselves to me. I do not know who they have sent over.
I am Terramus Matt.
I am Uncle Sam. When I say so, my feathers preen quite a bit, and my chest puffs out a little.
I'll nod and introduce myself as Anvil Icehammer.
I'll take the chairs that no one else is sitting on. Feet up and say, I'm Thump.
Well, excellent. Excellent. I'm glad you gentlemen are here and were able to arrive so promptly. We have until dawn to have this matter settled, and it's quite embarrassing. I would like to keep this quiet, but it needs to be taken care of immediately. The night watchman at one of my warehouses did not report in this morning, and neither has the day watchman. I sent a runner. I mean, this is from yesterday. I'm sorry, but I sent a runner over to address this and look into it, and they have not returned either. And I'm very concerned.
Well, okay. We're not your typical exterminators. What sort of pest do you expect us to encounter?
Well, he sighs. He looks a little nervous. He goes to the center drawer of the desk. He pulls it open and pulls out a large, polished black stone. It is cut and multifaceted, and sets it down on the desk. He says, "I was able to get this," and he runs his hand over top of it. And if any of you are familiar with magic at all, an illusion pops up. If you're not, you just see an image. And that image is the inside of a warehouse, it appears, except for there's a huge hole that's been blown into the floor, and it looks like it blew out. And there is like a ichor and greenish gunk all around the hole. on closer inspections, you see black veins running through it, and the image kind of pans up to the ceiling, where you see same substance, but it's attached to the ceiling, and also some kind of it's made of the same material, but they're globular in shape, and you're probably easy like 18 to 36 inches in diameter. It's really hard to tell from the image, but they look like balls or sacks of some sort. And anyone have knowledge nature?
I don't.
I do, actually.
Okay, so it looks like a really perverted version of either like fish egg sacs, or maybe some kind of like something an insect would lay.
My eagle-like eyes will kind of narrow in on that, and I will ask, are those fish eggs?
We're not really sure what it is. We believe there was an accident with one of the items we were storing for a client. And it appears during the night cycles, this stuff seems to be spreading and creeping out from its origination. And we don't really know what's in the hole yet. And my concern is, come nightfall tonight, that it is going to break free of the warehouse.
That must be quite the interesting storage facility.
Well, this doesn't seem like something that we would normally handle, and we may have been storing it without actually knowing exactly what it was. We may have been misled a little.
Okay, so your request is for us to destroy whatever these fish sacks are.
Yes, get rid of that and find the original object that seems to be the catalyst of the problem. And he reaches down underneath the desk and pulls out a large iron box and try and retrieve it in this. This should keep it contained and under control.
What is this object exactly we're looking for?
It's a crystal that looks a lot like that material that you've seen. It is about 18 inches long, and it is prismatic in its shape and appearance.
Someone playing with magic, never a good idea.
I'd like to kind of investigate, maybe, or Arcana, but looking at this box that he's handed us, does it look like a normal box, or is there anything particular about this particular box that he's handing?
Okay, so on closer inspection of it, you open it up, you look at it, you can actually see that there's scroll work in all throughout it. And if you have knowledge Arcana, then you just know that it's been worked with magic. Or at least the writing is, anyway.
Well, gentlemen, any other questions for our employer, or should we head over?
I'm ready to go when y'all are.
Likewise. Sooner finished.
Absolutely.
So he gives you the address of the warehouse and lets you know where you can find it. And again, I cannot express my need for
discretion
in this matter, absolutely.
As long as I get paid, you have my silence.
That shall not be a problem.
I nod my head and turn to leave.
Likewise.
Excellent. Thank you, gentlemen, and I appreciate your expedience.
I'll grab the box and take it with us.
So with that, within, you know, within another 20 minutes or so, you guys find yourself in the warehouse district. He actually had a coach waiting outside for you to help transport you there even faster. So, cut a little bit of time off.
I will fly overhead the coach, keeping a watch out and just following along.
Okay. So, you guys are outside of the warehouse from the outside. It looks nondescript, normal, well-kept. Everything. There's nothing too close to it, probably for security measures. And the only thing that strikes you as a little odd, as you investigate the exterior, there is a door that is slightly ajar.
Okay, I'm going to pull out my shield and carefully approach the door and push it open with the shield.
Okay. So as you begin pushing the door open, you can see inside that there's various crates and boxes and barrels all throughout this warehouse. The perimeter is clear so that you can walk around as an aisle, and then there's aisles that go up and down. The only thing is at the center of this warehouse, you can see that everything has been kind of disturbed and jumbled.
Also,
where the disturbance is, you can also see that palish green ichor with the veins shooting through it, and on the ceiling, you see that what he showed you.
Let's pull this door behind us, and I'm going to pull out my great axe, codenamed Complaint Department, and take a little sift through the area.
Okay. Someone asked about the lighting, I believe. So it's actually well lit, except for the center of the room. There's windows all around the upper story of the building, which is letting in the sunlight nicely. It's just it doesn't quite reach into the center of the room. And oddly enough, it's almost like the perimeter of that ichor, that greenish material kind of stops where the sunlight begins.
Okay. How tall is the ceiling?
The ceiling in here is 20 feet.
20 feet?
And we see egg sacks hanging from it, I assume?
You do.
Okay, I'm going to be a typical fighter. I'm going to throw my sword, that silvered, at it with an impromptu weapon throw.
Okay, well, you're probably going to have to get a bit closer because unless you guys have actually entered, it's a large warehouse, so...
Oh, yeah. Sorry. I'm thinking I'm walking through the aisle.
Yeah, so, which you can. And as you guys enter, as you do walk, you actually do hear some shuffling that's coming from around the center of the building.
Oh, okay, then I might not throw my sword just quite yet.
I'm going to pull out some food, any kind of ration or candy yams I got, whatever. Okay. Toss it ahead of me on the floor.
Okay, so you do that, and the shuffling, you hear it kind of go off in the direction of where you just threw the food, the rations.
And is that dark? Is it too dark to see what's shuffling, or is there just line of sight issues?
There, it's a combination of being dark and all that stuff is kind of like piled up. So it looks like there was an explosion in the center of the warehouse, and it kind of like blew out and pushed everything almost like in a ring.
Now I have devil sight, which allows me to see in magical and natural darkness. Am I able to see what's grabbing at that and what's shuffling or not? Or
is it yes, contrast with the light? You can actually catch glimpses of what's going on. So they're what you actually see is a small mob of, at first it just looks like four guys, but as you look a little bit closer, you can see they're actually covered in the same material that's on the ceiling and the floors. It's kind of like this pale greenish material with shot through with black veins. And when I say veins, they look like a person's veins.
I will relay this to my allies here and say it looks like there's some kind of a organic substance, veiny and whatnot, grabbing up on four people, four humanoid-looking shapes over there.
So there's a fourth person here, Night Watchman, Day Watchman, the Runner, and somebody else. They've been zergified.
I'm going to pull out my bowl-lit lantern and light it and point it towards the sound.
Why don't you let me handle the light? That way you have a free hand.
Okay.
I'll use a light cantrip.
Okay. So you guys are probably, 20, 30 feet away from the ring of debris. You have four figures there on the other side within, and so from the debris ring to the hole in the ground, there's probably like another 20 feet.
I'm going to put away my great axe, complaint department, and pull out my great club named Mr. Mean, and I'm going to see if I can't take one of these guys alive. I'm going to actually start walking over towards the edge where his name, where Alan had pointed out, see what I can see. Something comes closer or moves away. Try to detect their fright level.
Okay. So as you do that, and the longer you guys spend in here, you start to get hit with the odor, and it almost smells like stagnant water or something that's rotten. It's tolerable, but it's definitely unpleasant. As you move forward, you just normally making normal noise, not trying to be stealthy. So as you do that, the figures begin to shuffle back towards where you're headed. They seem to be attracted or drawn by the noise.
Cool, so I don't have to chase them.
No, and as you guys get closer and observe them more, you can see that their flesh seems to be putrefying, and that stuff is just totally melted with them all over them, and even covering their eyes, and they almost look bloated, like they've been sitting at the bottom of the river or an ocean or something.
Thump, I don't think I'd let that stuff get on you.
I agree. Well, I'm still over there. I want to see if one of these little critters or all four of them want to come out.
I'm going to move up to flank him just in case.
Okay, so they begin trying to climb the debris, but they're very clumsy. They don't move particularly well, but they are beginning to climb it. And the debris is in some places like 5 foot high, other places 10 foot high. It's very uneven. Obviously it's just the stuff that was in the warehouse that just got pushed.
And a quick question: how high is the ceiling in here?
20 feet.
I will take flight and try and fly a little bit closer to these guys, staying out of arm's reach to try and to not be with my allies in case they got some kind of splatter attack or something, but also to get closer and see what these guys look like up close and what they're, try to discern what their reaction is going to be if they notice me. Not taking any type of stealth action or anything, but
okay.
Not hovering, but flying around 10 feet high, maybe 11, 12, somewhere out of what I would imagine would be their jumping range.
Okay, well, just by looking at them, you're thinking they don't jump very well at all. So you know, now that you observe them a little bit more, and they've just about made it to the top of the rubble pile, you notice that two of them seem to have, where you can see clothing, you can see that they're dressed the similar, if not the same.
Looks like we figured out what happened to their night guard.
Looks like it.
The question is, do we destroy them or contain them?
Well, I would say if this is magic-based, which based on the scrollwork on that box, it would be, you destroy them. Nothing of this can be good.
So with that, I think we'll go to an initiative. So if you guys just want to drop initiative for me.
A mighty 5.
11.
If you guys can put it in the chat, that would be great. And what do you got, Bert?
Sorry, I thought you could see it over there in the dice roller. 4. All
right. All right, so they lumber towards the three of you. And while you're checking them out, they apparently have gotten a burst of speed going down the other side of the rubble. And they charge forth. Let's see. And two of them are going for you, Aaron, and one is going for Alan and Bert. I mean, not Alan. Alan's in the sky. William and Bert. So it comes lumbering in with its fist and swings at you, Aaron, and I don't think it's going to hit. It's very slow and clumsy. So does a 13 hit?
No.
You said you're wearing plate, right?
Correct. Plus a shield, plus the 1% for wearing heavy armor. Or one for protection.
And Bert, you know, one lumbers in your direction. It slams its fist down on the ground right next to you. These things appear to have horrible vision, William, as the other one does the same thing to you. And up close, now that you can see them up close, it looks like that material that's all over them is probably added a good 50 to 100 pounds. Of bulk to these creatures. They're very misshapen and kind of lumpy in spots. And they smell even worse this close.
Okay, so...
Actually, you guys both have 11, so... However you want to do it, Aaron or Will.
You want to go first, Will?
Thank you much. Yeah, I'm going to take a swing at him with Mr. Mean, my great club. And I get a 1. That's a modified 1. Fuck it, whatever.
So a great club just went sailing by. I think as you went to swing, you know, like you got a good whiff of these things and you kind of like threw up in your mouth a little bit, just totally threw you off.
Worse than me in the garbage. I think one of us get two attacks. How do we resolve that? Do I make my other attack right now?
You can draw another weapon as a free action, so yeah, you could.
Could you repeat that? You went all robotic.
Sorry. I pull out my great axe. I rolled an 18.
Okay, so 25 to hit.
Cool, 25 to hit. Is that 1d12 plus 4? I rolled a 1 for damage. So 5 damage.
Nice.
Freaking stream.
Okay, that ends your turn, Will?
Yeah, I believe it does.
Yeah, sorry, I'm done.
Okay, so I'm going to swing at the closest one to me with my silver sword, natural 20 crit. So I do 1d8 plus 5, so 13 damage.
Okay, so you slice it right up the center, and this black ooze just starts pouring out, but it doesn't seem all that phased.
Well, I'm going to use my extra attack action, and I miss horribly with a 1.
And so far, these creatures have not made any vocalizations whatsoever.
Yeah, I figure they're for some form of undead.
All right, so the 5 is up next.
Seeing that Maul, what did you say his name was? Meanie or something? I will swoop down with an eagle scream, like, and grab that Maul and fly back to my buddy and hand it to him as a interact action. And can I still cast a spell at the same time, or will that be my action?
I'll let you interact. I'll let that be an interact. That's fine.
All right. Then swooping over him, kind of dropping the Maul next to him, I'll take an Eldritch Blast at the one that just that's right there in front of us. And that'll be a 17 to AC. So I assume that'll hit. Oh. Or no?
Yep. Yep, that hits.
Alright, with the first laser being a 10 and the second one being an 8, so 18 plus. Now, do I add my charisma to both lasers or just to each attack die with the agonizing blast?
You can add it to both.
Alright, so it'll be 18 plus another 8, so 26 points of damage, and that guy has flown 10 feet back from us, from being in our face. The evocations I have are Agonizing Blast, Repelling Blast, Devil Sight, and Voice of the Chain Master for my familiar, which has not made an appearance yet.
Okay. So you can actually roll an additional die 6 because he runs out of room as it slams into the rubble.
That'll be a mighty 1.
Okay. So again, these things have not made a single sound or vocalization. And you're up, Bert.
17 with Sacred Flame, which is 2d8 radiant damage, okay. Save versus dex.
All right, so... Yeah, 4. That's not going to do it, is it?
Ah, it's a deck save, so.
Yeah, so it's a I got a 4. So, what's the damage?
Damage is 9. And that's the one in front of me.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. So far, you guys have all attacked different ones.
I think Alan and Aaron are both on the same guy.
No, we both attacked ones closest to us. I had 2 attack me, so.
Alright, so they are going to basically just use the same tactics that they used the last round. And Aaron, to in front of you, are going to swing wildly and does a. Does a 19 hit?
No, sir.
So the one completely misses you altogether in its lumbering movement. And the other one, you know, it hits, but it deflects off your shield. And you can just feel the force of the blows. And you're thankful for that armor that you have slathered on.
Hey.
All right. Bert, does a 22 hit you?
It certainly does.
All right. So it basically comes in with the Hulk smash maneuver, pummeling down with both of its fists. For a whopping 7 points of damage.
Okay.
And the final one. Oh, okay, 19 on the die. So that is a 25 at you, Will. So I'm going to figure that probably hits. And this one is a bit more successful, doing 14 points of damage as meaty fist after meaty fist slams into you.
Okay. I'm down to 68, so let's get these things, because I'm hurt really bad.
top of the order? Yeah, top of the order. The 11s are up.
All right, that's me. And I'm going to go for my two attacks. Actually, I'm going to rage out a little. Gonna Hulk out.
Okay.
My first attack, I rolled a 2. And my second attack, this is just great.
What? Oh, not 2. Tell me the actual number, though.
Oh, okay. 9.
So, even though you're horribly off in your swing, it actually lumbers into it.
They have negative AC. That used to mean something in second edition.
Yeah, it means something good.
Okay, then I do 11, 12 points, since I'm raging, 14 points of damage right back to that guy.
Okay.
And then the second guy, 6, 11, 12, 13. I rolled 13 to hit.
Yep.
So, my damage is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 11
so,
damage.
So when you hitting with the club or the axe?
No, the axe. I don't want to take the time to pick up the club.
Okay. So when you slam down on it with your axe, you nearly from the head down, it almost as you cleave into it, and then all of a sudden there's this like popping sound, and it just explodes out. The three of you can give me a dex save.
I fell dex save with a 3.
Okay. So it's not so bad as acid washes over all of you. Anyone that got a dex save of under 13 take points of damage, half if you made the save. Or if your resist acid for whatever reason.
Oh, what did you say? How many points of damage?
It was 6.
Okay.
As green ichor washes over all three of you.
Note to self, use the club.
Now the other two creatures that also got hit by it didn't seem to bother them at all.
Okay.
And Will, you still have your second attack to resolve too, so.
Oh, I actually resolved it. I got a hit for 11 points of damage. But I would like to use the flat of the axe.
Okay. Is that on a one of the injured ones or a fresh one?
One of the injured ones.
Okay. All right, good enough. And I believe you're up, Aaron?
Okay. I'm going to cast the spell Thunderwave at the ones in front of us. And that's going to hit anything within a 15-foot cube in front of me for 2d8 on a constitution save.
Okay. So... yeah, so one of my favorite spells of 5th edition.
So the ones that don't make the save take 8 points of damage after for anyone that does.
Okay, so they both made the save, so they both take half damage, and they're not moved.
Nope, not moved. Oh, that ends my turn.
Okay, so 5. I believe that was you, Alan?
It is. Is there any of these creatures that are up on anybody's face right now, or are they all at least a few feet back?
No, they're all around them right now. Everybody's in melee.
Okay, I will pick 2 of them that are closest to... who did that sacred flame?
I did, Bert.
Is that Anvil, I'm assuming?
Yes, that is Anvil.
I will pick the two that are closest towards Anvil, because I have a feeling that guy can cast some healing spells, and I will attempt to knock them away. My first Eldritch Blast will be a miss at a 2.
What's the final number? Yeah,
the final number is a 9.
That hits.
Okay, then the 5 will also hit. I will do 10 points of damage on that first blast and knock that guy 10 feet away. And the second blast will also do 10 points of damage and the first one only did 9 points of damage. The second one did 10 points of damage. But both of those creatures I would like to knock 10 feet away from Anvil.
Okay. You can absolutely do that.
I'm going to cast Sacred Flame if it's my turn.
It is.
Total to hit is 14.
Yep, it absolutely hits.
Damage is 12.
Okay. Do you have to make an attack roll with Sacred Flame?
Yeah, I have to roll to hit. I don't know whether I do or not.
I don't think you do, because...
that's right, because it has a dex save.
Yeah, generally if you're making a saving throw.
12 damage.
All right. Okay, so they do not pass the save. And it is completely engulfed in your sacred flames. Pardon me. And you know, it's almost like the flames rain down on it, and then like it catches fire, and yeah, you see like the first response you've seen out of any of them, where it throws its head back, arms out, in a silent scream, and you kind of see like its mouth and his eyes light up with your sacred flame, and then explodes. But because it's 10 feet away, the acid lands, you know, just at your feet. Alan, you're in the sky. What is your passive perception?
I passively perceive at 11.
You hear a ripping sound above you. And if you look up, you see that those sacks are starting to peel apart. And you see things trying to wriggle their way out of them.
What do these things look like? Are they spider-like or?
No, they're right now. All you can see is a couple of heads popping out, and you can see that the head is, first of all, they're really small, tiny creatures, and you can see the chitin all over the face and the head of the creature, multifaceted bulbous eyes and mandibles, and from between them you see the mandibles like opening and closing, and then you see something like flicking out of those mandibles. Well, out from between the mandibles where the mouth would be. It almost looks like a snake tongue, you know, the way it would, but except for it's not forked, and it seems rigid. But that flicking motion kind of like reminds you of that.
I will call out to my companions, be like, hey, these things up here are starting to pop.
Great.
They sense us below. Mind you, this is coming from an ape intelligence. They sense more life below. We need to finish this up quick.
So, okay, so you guys all went, and there's just the two creatures on the ground in front of you. And, basically, they don't really, they don't change tactics. They keep doing the same thing they've been doing. So the two that have been in front of Aaron and are still there just keep trying to hammer away, completely oblivious of anything else that's going on.
So whose turn is it?
It's their turn. I'm just waiting for... there it goes. Nah, it's okay. It was just being a little slow tonight, the dice roller. So an 18 and a 20 on Aaron.
Doesn't hit.
Okay, so again, you know, the meaty thumps of their fists bouncing off of your armor.
I'm glad I have a shield right now.
And the levens are up.
All right. I've never done this before. Can I my battle master techniques while I'm raging?
You know what? Which one do you want to use?
Sweeping attack.
So basically, yeah, I'll allow that.
Sexy. All right. 15. And superiority die. Let me drop this. Oh, duh, and I forgot to roll the regular damage for the first one. Okay, 11. 15 damage on the first one, and on the second one that got hit in the sweep, 12 damage. Flats of the axe.
Okay. Okay, so you slam into it twice with the flat of your axe, knocking it from side to side. It's still on its feet, though.
That was to both of them. The first one got hit with the first roll of damage. Okay. The second one... Okay. If I get my second attack, I'd like to do the exact same thing.
Okay.
But this time in the opposite direction. If I can... I'll just roll the hit first. Yeah, I should hit with a 19.
Absolutely.
So the first one... 13 damage. Superiority die. Okay, here's the funny question. with my barbarian ability of, what is it, reckless attack, where I get to re-roll ones and twos for damage, can that count for superiority dice if I just roll the one?
It's just for weapon die.
Okay. Okay, so the damage for this guy then is 5.
Okay.
That's my round.
So,
go ahead.
What was the damage on the second one? Because for the sweep, 5. Right? Okay, so that was the 5. Okay.
Yes. I actually like to do my action surge.
Okay.
Action surge, that's what it's called, right? Yeah. Okay, then. Yeah, just regular attack. 13 damage. At 13 to hit. Okay, I can reroll that one. 10 is awesome. 10 plus my 4, so 14 damage. 16. Shoot, 16 damage on him. I'm still raging, so it's an extra 2 points of damage.
It is.
Which, if you'll still allow it, still my turn. That's an extra 4 to each of the damages before.
Okay, so with that. The two remaining creatures both explode, almost like you just almost like popping a pimple. So the three of you can give me 2 dex saves. All right, so I'm going to say the 20 passed, but the 2 did not. So on the first attack would have been 9, so you can take half of that. If you pass, then the second attack is for 8.
9 plus 8. And
the noises from above are getting louder.
Now that we don't have goo monsters in front of us, I'm going to look up and see what I can see.
So now what you see, it looks, they look like almost like snakes with bug heads. On them, and you know the their long sinuous body is like covered in chitin, and they have like a multitude of legs, almost like a centipede. They look kind of hooked, and their wings are between an insect and a bat. They're kind of shaped like a bat wing, the way they move, and they're kind of translucent like an insect wing. And they're very small. They're like a foot long each.
I don't like being up here with these things. Are we still in initiative order?
Yes.
All right, I will wait.
Okay. So with these things coming out, you said there were shoving units. How high are the shoving units?
They go about 15 feet into the air in some places, in all, you know, in a row. So yeah, 15 feet.
Okay.
So like 5-5 sections.
Okay. So I will just ready my, or I'll stand in a defensive position waiting for them to come.
Okay. Bert, you had a 5, or Alan, you had the 5?
I have the 5.
Okay.
Looking at these egg sacs, do they appear to be attached to the roof in like a way that could be cut down, or are they like kind of more like a smear of egg sac?
It is kind of like a smear, but you could probably still cut them down.
In that case, I will fly the rest of the way up to them, hopefully staying out of range of these little things, but definitely getting within range and using the claws on my feet, my talons. I will attempt to cut some of the stuff off so that it falls down below to where my melee companions can start smashing.
Okay.
Do you want an attack roll on them, or what do you need from me?
Give me an attack roll. It's not so much to see if you hit, but to see if you can actually slice through.
I only hit at a 9.
Yeah, that'll do it. They're not moving, so.
Yeah. And it'll be 4 points of slashing damage from my talons.
It is just barely hanging on.
I've only got 1 attack, so that's about it. With that, I will tuck my wings down and swoop down to the ground level.
Your talons are considered light weapons, so you could take a second attack as a bonus action.
I will do so. I roll higher on the bonus to hit, or the actual hit, and do another 3 points of slashing damage.
Okay. So roll 2d6 for the falling damage.
9.
Okay. So you did 9 damage to the creatures in the sack from falling, and now the sack is kind of upside down and on them, so it's going to take those ones a little bit longer to get out. So they're going to be delayed.
Awesome.
And you wanted to drop?
Yes, I wanted to tuck my wings back and return to the ground next to my companions.
Okay.
I definitely don't want to get swarmed by whatever the hell these things are up there.
Okay, so Bert, you are up.
I'm going to attack one of those critters that hit the floor by using Sacred Flame.
Okay.
That is 13 damage.
Okay. They get a saving throw.
Dex.
I'm going to give them that saving throw at disadvantage because of them being still kind of trapped. Which they fail, so they take the damage. You said 13 damage?
Yes.
Okay. So there's a lot of sizzling and popping going on. And okay, with that, the other egg bursts open and they come rushing out. And let's see, what do I want? I want one of these. All right, Aaron, they're heading your way.
All right.
How many of them?
How many of them? It's they just swarm all around you, and it ends up actually being more disconcerting and gross than anything. They're not able to actually penetrate your armor in any of its spots. Although you're a little concerned if they're left to their devices, they might start wiggling their way through.
Okay, so they attack me?
They do, and it was ineffectual.
Okay, so is that the end of their turn?
It is.
Okay, well, you're up.
Well, I'm going to come down with my axe like it's a shovel, see what I can see what I can smash here. That's got a hit. That's about a 21.
Yep, that will hit.
I re-roll that weak 2, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. I'm still raging, so 12 damage.
So you sweep your axe through these things, and they just start splattering left and right. But there's just so many of them.
Well, my second attack, I hit with an 18. I rolled an 18, so I know I got higher than that. Max damage. Oh, 30, 14, 15, 16, 18 damage.
Okay. So same thing. You just cleave through these things, and body parts are flying everywhere. It's flying everywhere, but there's just so many of them.
That's it for me.
Okay.
And you're up, Aaron.
I am going to cast Burning Hands.
Okay.
In front of me. They can make a dex throw of or dex save of 11 to take half damage. 3d6. Fine. 10 damage.
All right. So they're going to take half.
I never said I was a very good wizard.
Well, it was a 20 on the save, so it's probably better for you guys that it was on the save and not an attack roll.
Probably.
All right, Alan, what are you doing?
So there's a swarm of these things. Is the other still encased in the egg sack on the ground, or are both swarms now?
Yeah, the ones are working their way out, and it looks like they're going to be getting out any second now.
I will use my create bonfire cantrip to burn that egg sack and that space. That'll give them a dex save, or they take 8 points of damage. Wow, max damage, ghetto crit. Fire damage, if that matters.
Okay. What's your DC?
My spell save is 15.
I imagine it's higher than a 10, so... Alright, and you did 8 points of damage?
I did.
Okay. So they are sizzling and they are popping.
And I will maintain concentration on that. There's now a bonfire in that area that they will take damage if they start or end their turn in that space.
Okay. Well, they're going to clearly start their turn there very shortly. And for the first time, too, since you guys began battle, these creatures are making noises when you hit them, when you swing at them. The noise is like some cross between like an insect or a reptile. It's just this hard screeching sounds. And you are up, Bert.
Okay, I'm going to step a little bit closer to that egg sack on the ground.
Okay.
And I'm going to slam my hammer against my shield, call on Thor's name, and blast a thunder wave.
Okay.
At the same time, I'm going to... use my channel divinity for destructive wrath, which gives me max damage.
Ooh, nice.
19 to hit.
You don't have to roll to hit.
So that is going to be, I think, 16 damage.
Oh yeah, you did max. That's right. I'm waiting for you to be a number. Basically told me. Okay, so I dropped an 18 on the die, so I'm assuming that's going to pass. So they take half, which is 8. And essentially, bits of these creatures and flames and fire shoot everywhere away from you as you totally destroy that egg and its contents.
The power of Thor.
Nice. I will give a caca victory as that egg sack melts.
With that, the swarm continues around Aaron, trying to find purchase through that shell of his.
Hey, you gave me 2,000 gold. I'm going to spend it on good armor.
That's it. Make it count. So, all right. And that is a 25 to hit.
That hits me.
Finally. Hallelujah. Give me a constitution saving throw.
Constitution. 26.
Okay. So you're gonna pass that save. You're going to take 4 points of damage, but what you do feel is they actually find chinks in your armor. Remember that thing I said you saw flicking out from between their mandibles?
Mm-hmm.
Well, as they bite at you, those things flick into your skin and they start pumping you full of a substance, and it just burns. It is not poison.
Okay.
And you are going to take... Oh, nice. 10 points of acid damage after halving it.
Okay. The original damage it did, was it piercing, bludgeon, or what?
The original damage was piercing, yes.
Okay, is it magical?
It is not.
Okay, so I take a total of 11 points of damage.
Okay. Heavy armor master.
Yes.
Sweet.
Build a tank, you might as well do it right.
Absolutely. So with that, you're up, Will.
Okay. Thump is going to... Thump. Go after these things again. Okay. Hit. 4, 8, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 damage. Another one hit. 4... 12 damage.
Okay, so one of the things by this point, you're realizing that while you're mowing through them with every axe swing, it's just not as effective as it could be, because it's a bunch of little creatures, and you know, some of them, instead of getting actually injured, they just kind of get knocked out of the way, or you completely miss them. But you're definitely thinning out the swarm. And it is greatly diminished.
Mind you, using the flat, so I can kind
of... Yep.
Use it like a shovel. But, okay.
And Aaron, you're up.
Okay, so these things are swarming around me, and they're attacking me. If I use Shocking Grasp on myself, will I hit them?
If you shot, I will let you channel Shocking Grasp through yourself.
Okay. Takes 2 points of damage.
Okay.
Well, do I have to make an attack roll because I'm channeling it through myself?
No, I won't even require the attack roll, as long as you take 2 points of damage, too.
Hey, I was planning on taking the damage.
So a bunch of them jerk around as electricity goes through them from clinging to you, and the ones that were clinging to you immediately let go.
Excellent.
And take inspiration for Shocking Grasping yourself.
Nice.
Matter of fact, everybody can start with inspiration, and Aaron, you now have 2 inspiration.
Okay. Oh, and as a bonus action, I'm going to second wind.
Okay.
For 11 points. And then I'm going to end my turn, because that hurt.
All right, Alan, you're up.
I'm going to let my concentration on that bonfire go and watch the flames just sort of smolder down into whatever is just glowing, and attempt to Eldritch Blast on this swarm, sending a couple of these nether lasers through it. First attack will be a 17. Second attack will be a 21. I would like to move it if possible, but I understand it being a swarm, it's probably not going to move the entire thing.
Yeah, that is true, but your two blasts actually obliterate it.
Awesome.
And pieces go flying everywhere, so.
With that, I'll give a little, like, shudder going, ah, I hate bugs.
And with that, things go eerily silent in the warehouse. And there is a couple more of those sacks on the ceiling if you guys want to get rid of them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wouldn't want them dropping on us in an inopportune time.
So with that, I'll actually say, Alan, you could have kept your bonfire going, concentrating on it if you wanted to.
Okay. Keeping the bonfire, well, it's a cantrip, so I can always bring it back at will.
That's true. So fire seemed to work pretty well, and you don't hear any noises from these ones, so they might not be ripe yet.
I will aim at one of them and definitely put a like as we come up to each one, I will torch them with a bonfire and maintain concentration until they die, or do you want to fight out all of these?
No, you don't have to roll or anything. You just go through the motions of concentrating on each one, and you hear the sizzling and the popping, and the ichor begins to run, and then finally you hear the screams of these immature or premature creatures begin echo out from within the fire as they burn to death.
Awesome.
So it just takes you a couple rounds, and then you've completely cleared the ceiling of any of those.
While he is doing that, I am going to begin casting a spell, which has a 10-minute cast time.
Okay.
I'm going to check over the corpses of what I assume are the guards and make an arcana check on them. Which I fell horribly with the one.
Okay, well, you basically, when you look at them, you can see they, clearly they used to be, two of them were clearly the guards. You scrape away some stuff and really look, and you see they all used to be humans and probably residents of the city here. And, and they've been horribly mutated somehow. And, judging by the ichor that had spewed forth from them, whatever was human in them before, nothing was left.
After burning these eggs, looking at this ichor, does this look like something that's been applied over top of these bodies or something that's, like, oozing up from within them? Or is it melded to them?
Actually, I misspoke a little bit, because you can't actually examine the bodies because they exploded.
Oh, yeah, they did.
in a wash of acid, so there really isn't much to look at anymore.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, I'm still going to look at it because I got a one.
Yeah, well, that's true. And you could, now that you've had time to examine things, the one thing you are noticing, the stuff that sprayed on you, while it burned your skin and the flesh it touched, anything that was inorganic, it's sticking to. And and it's completely, it's complete with, it's like kind of stuck, stuck to spots on your armor, and you can see like those black veins starting to form in it.
Oh, great.
You should get a penicillin shot for that.
So anyone that's actually been caught in the explosion of them will notice the same thing. Like even your clothes, it seems to be sticking to weapons, you know, anything that's not organic.
Okay.
Hope is not too bright. So after our Arakoka friend says to do the penicillin, I start rubbing a piece of bread on his armor.
When you do that, you know, your hand actually brushes up against some of the stuff, and it's actually kind of warm and feels a little meaty. And it's also kind of like spongy.
Perhaps we should build a fire and try and get close to it, get the stuff off.
Well, if you take anything, a dagger, a blade, or whatever, it scrapes right off.
Yeah, that's exactly what it's going to do. Moving up to my plate mail friend, I'll pull out a dagger and try and scrape it off and see what happens when it's flicked from the dagger onto the ground, if it starts to like smoke or
it
die.
Just kind of splats on the ground. Well, actually, you do that, and some of it actually lands in the sunlight, and it seems to like wither a little bit.
Score. Sunbath.
You guys might want to go outside for a second and get that stuff burned off.
That sounds like a good idea.
Within minutes, it actually just kind of dries up and just flakes off.
All right.
Stuff seems to have some kind of aversion to sunlight.
So obviously necromantic in origin.
So we could have probably saved those guys' lives, maybe, if we would have brought them outside.
They were already gone.
I would... your character may not figure it out because he's got a low intelligence, but some of the other ones would probably think that probably not, because that stuff seemed to be inside and out of them, so...
I feel a little better.
Okay, so...
What are you guys doing now?
Is my spell completed?
Yes.
Everybody will receive 14 hit points from Prayer of Healing.
Nice.
Thank you, good sir. Okay, now...
Can we take a short rest?
I'm feeling perfectly capable of pushing on, but if you're feeling a little bit tired, big guy, I mean, we could take a nap.
Yeah, I could still be raging.
So
we could call just bathing in the sun for a minute, a short rest. I mean, shoot. Whatever.
Okay.
So one of the things that our group's been kicking around with is altering the short rest down to, like, you know, anywhere from 30. We've thrown out anywhere from 30 minutes to 10 minutes for a short rest. So for today, we'll implement the 30 minutes. So if you guys want to take 30 minutes short rest, you guys have already spent 10 minutes anyway. So
I don't mind that.
Now we can hang around for another 20 minutes.
Appreciate this.
While we're sitting around doing this, I'm going to look up at the ceiling and I'm going to try to judge how thick it is.
How thick the ceiling is?
Yes.
It's standard lumber.
Standard.
So 2x4, so like, you know, 2 inches thick plus whatever, you know, roofing material they put on top of that, you know, it's probably between 4 and 6 inches of thickness.
Okay.
While we're doing this short rest, you had said that there was some sort of spider hole that the employer told us about that these things came out of.
Yeah, it was in the center of the rubble of the ring of debris, and it's pretty big. It's like 15 foot radius.
While we're taking this short rest, right as we start, I'm gonna open up my backpack and pull out my familiar, who is a homunculus, He's kind of like a little clay version of a... more or less looks exactly like the DM guide thing, that creepy-looking thing.
Okay.
Because I am a Pact of the Chain, and I will sit down in sort of like a meditative sense, or sit, squat down like a bird sitting on a nest, more or less, close my eyes, and will him to go into that spider hole and take a look around and try and figure out what's going on, and just the entire time just looking through his eyes and more or less scouting ahead until he sees anything that looks dangerous, at which point he'll try and sneak back.
Okay, so as it descends into the hole goes down about 30 feet, that stuff is all over the walls. So it literally is as if the stuff like creeped its way all the way up the walls, onto the floors, over that debris pile. And now that you guys have had a chance to really like look at things, you can see that that even on the ceiling, it's literally gone to where the sunlight has stopped it from going any further. So that's the first thing that your little friend finds. You know, there's a decent size chamber down below. It's rough hewn walls. Again, there the walls, the floor, the ceiling, everything is coated in that substance. The other thing too is that it's dimly lit because the stuff apparently in complete darkness glows. So a light eerie green color. From there, that's like a 30 by 30 chamber. There's a tunnel that comes off of here. And if you wish to send your homunculus down there, you can. It's up to you.
I'll for the moment, I'll tell him just to hang out where he is and hide. And the last couple minutes of our little short rest, I will use the minor illusion cantrip and more or less make a 3D image of everything that I saw through his eyes, showing the and say, this is what we're going down into, and make like a little floating holographic 3D image of the tunnel and the room and the way it's glowing and looking and whatnot.
Okay, so he could see down the tunnel off of that chamber, which was roughly 10, 15 foot wide, a good 30 feet down the way. There was an object jutting out of the ground in the center of another area where it opens up, but he couldn't really see how big it opened up because of him being on the other side of the tunnel. And you think you saw some things sparkling and reflecting light off of that object that's jutting out of the floor, about 4 foot high, like chest level to a human.
After showing what he's seen so far, I'll close my eyes back into and see using the Pact of the Chain of the Carcieri, whatever the hell that ability is called, pronounced as, and send him to examine whatever that is. Does it look like a prismatic crystal?
It does not, but when he gets closer to it and gets into the chamber, you can see that there's actually crystals all along the walls at different intervals. And so what it is, it's almost like a little obelisk, and it also, on the top, where it's kind of like pyramided, there's different crystals on there, on each of the sides.
Did the color of these crystals matter, or... like, what color are the crystals? Are they glowing the same color green, or are they a different color? Or?
They're actually a different color. There's black crystals, there's light blue crystals, there's some clear crystals, amethyst-colored crystals, and some ruby-looking crystals.
I'm going to direct him to fly up to that obelisk thing and touch it.
Okay, so when he touches it, it's covered with the same material that covers everything in this place, and it's warm to the touch. There's a slight pulse to it. The black veins are running through it, and you're connected to its mind.
Yes, telepathically with the telepathic bond. I can perceive and speak through him with my voice with the last incantation that I took.
Okay, so you feel something, because it's more of a can do it to you than anything, you feel something touching your mind lightly.
And if it matters, my pact is of the old one, Zargon, so if that makes a difference to you.
It actually does. This thing, it feels very otherworldly and alien. Not in a familiar way either.
I will disengage my mind from my homunculus, returning my consciousness to my party friends, still sitting like a chicken on an egg and another minor illusion cantrip of this particular room, and say, there's something alien in there, guys. I don't know what it is, and I know a lot about some weird stuff. I've never felt something as weird as this.
I'm even going to go, because you have the pack of the old one, to say that you were actually even able to discern that you felt a psychic resonance coming off of it.
Huh. And how does that manifest? What does that mean, precisely?
Well, so to you, telepathic capabilities, the ability to operate mind to mind, and not from magic, but from, possibly like psionics or some other power.
I will also relay that, tell everybody, there's some kind of psychic or cosmic connection here. I've felt stuff similar to this before, but I don't know. This one is alien to me. It's different.
Does it seem sentient?
Did I feel a sentience behind it when it was touching my mind, or did it feel more like a well of power, or what did it? How did that feel?
It felt more like the well of power feeling. It did not feel like it was another mind per se. It feels like it felt more like that this thing was imbued with psychic energy.
I didn't feel like it was aware of me so much as a reservoir or an imbued with some kind of psychic energy.
Interesting. I'm going to turn to Anvil and ask him if he has the daylight spell prepared.
You there, Bert?
No, I don't have daylight prepared.
Okay. Would have been nice, but we can deal without it.
And this was a hole down into it, like traveled down underground, right? There's not a roof in that chamber that would open into open air?
No, it does not open into open air. It is underground. It is deep enough, too, that would actually be beneath the sewers of the city in most places.
Well, let's light some torches and go down. Watch your feathers.
I get really nervous about this idea and go, man, I hate going underground. Can't see the sky or stretch your wings. It's horrible down there. I don't know how you people go live underneath stuff like that.
Because only birds are afraid of snake holes.
Okay, so I guess I head back in towards the hole, rummaging through my pack to find my strand of rope.
Okay.
Because you said it was about a 30-foot drop, right?
Plenty of stuff up here. Yeah, and there's plenty of stuff up here that you could find something to tie the rope off to.
So I'm going to find something to tie the rope off to and then throw it down into the hole.
I'm going to start going down too, trying to one hand repel it and have a torch in the other hand.
I'll cover the light. Don't worry about your torch, unless you want to use it to burn stuff.
Maybe, because This stuff doesn't like fire.
I'll grab a hold of your torch and fly down to the bottom of the hole, holding it down there, waiting for you guys to come on down so you can climb easily enough.
You guys are totally ruining his mojo. He just wanted to be a real man and climbed out one arm.
I want to go like Uncharted.
Is it going to be a real drop where I have a chance of falling?
With the rope, you could get down easy enough without any problems, but it is 30 feet, so that wouldn't tickle.
Well, I'm just making sure I don't need to make a climb check.
No, that's not necessary.
Okay. Because that would hurt if I fell.
Unless someone starts shaking the rope up above or something. So you guys find yourself in this chamber. And again, you know, you don't even need the torch to see, per se, but in case you want to burn things, you have it. Which is, you know, it's about 30, 40 feet in diameter. It seems like it's all rough hewn, though it's hard to tell because you can't actually see any of the stonework lying beneath. It's just more of that stuff. It feels kind of weird when your feet touch down. And actually, you would have felt it before even entering the hole. As you walk across it, it feels like you know, walking across like tumbling mats or wrestling mats. That spongy feel. And there's only one way out of this chamber. Off the one corner, there's a tunnel. Again, it's about 10, 15 feet wide, and it only runs, you know, about 20, 30 feet before it opens up into another chamber. And in that chamber was the one I described. It's actually circular in nature with all of these different crystals all over the wall. It kind of looks like, you guys remember Land of the Lost, the Sleestaks?
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
So it kind of looks like that, except for, and then you have the obelisk in the center of the room. And it's only roughly shaped like an obelisk because it's not really symmetrical. It's kind of cylinder in shape, but not quite. It's because it's rough and bumpy, but it does come up to the top, where it does come to almost like a steep point all the way around. There's four sides, and in those sides, each one holds five different crystals of various colors, and they don't seem to correspond to anything per se.
I want to try and break one of these crystals off. Is that a possibility? I'll ask one of my strong companions, because I'm not all that, and I've kind of got these little frail bird bones. Can one of you guys break one of these off for me?
I'll snap it. I got an 18.
Okay, so drop a d20 and see what happens.
He's got a smug look. This was a dumb idea.
You just got me killed. I rolled a 6 plus my 4, 10.
Oh, yeah, you usually pop one off. The DM makes a saving throw not to make this thing a mimic.
Now this, the crystal that's inside of this like black veiny stuff, does that have a different color, or is it just covered in this black veiny stuff?
No, it's almost like the stuff grew around the crystals.
So that's more towards like the base rather than up and on the crystals themselves.
The veins aren't on the crystals. Like, and actually, now that since you mentioned it, like where each crystal is, there's veins that go into like the different sides of the crystals, but it doesn't actually go into the crystals, just where the crystals like inset.
Mm-hmm. Him snapping that off, was it a snap, or did it seem like he pulled it out of a socket?
It was like a sucking sound when he pulled it out. It was a little gross.
Well, nonetheless, I hand it to him.
Looking at it and whatnot, I'll try and make an arcana check or whatever type of roll that you need for me to see if I can figure anything out about this thing.
Okay.
Or
so, So as long as you're willing and not afraid, you start touching them, and you get like these mental or psychic vibrations, almost like chimes in your head, and touching different ones makes different sounds. And pardon me. And at times, you know when you've like gotten it horribly wrong, not because anything really bad happens, but it just makes this awful discord. Sound.
Yeah.
Yes.
I'm gonna ask everybody else while this is happening. Do you guys hear these resonating sounds, or is this just me?
They do not. Oh, all of them do not, except for Will, who's holding a crystal.
I hear it.
This is some weird stuff right here. Maybe we should put this crystal back. And I will try and stick it back in its little slurpy goopy hole.
It almost like vacuums right back into place.
And do I feel anything mentally while that happens, or no?
Are you just putting the one crystal back in?
I don't have the other one, so...
Okay, so nothing happens, but it does, as it sinks back into place, it does make kind of like a pleasant chiming sound.
So approximately how many crystals are there?
In the obelisk itself, there's 20. And then, you know, a quick glance around the room, you can see there's probably easily, you know, 100 or more set in the walls.
Shall we start removing them?
And looking at them, you don't know, like, you don't know off just by looking at them if they're valuable or what their value would be. You've all been around for a while, so you've been exposed to different gems, and none of these feel like those. Not to say they couldn't be valuable, they're just beyond your scope of experience.
And is there anything to make this room look like it might? Because this was a collapsed spider hole that came into here. This wasn't a room that was designed, or basically, does this look like a man-made room or a humanoid-made room or a natural type cavern?
It looks more like a natural type cavern.
Does the green slime stuff seem to emanate from any area in this room and then head out of here?
No, because it's everywhere. Like, it would be really, you'd be hard pressed to find a beginning and an end.
And we see no other exits to this room?
There is no other exits to this room.
Well, I'm of mind to let my barbarian friend go smash happy in here. Just let me go outside while he does that, outside this room.
Alan, give me an intelligence check. You can use Arcana.
All right, that'll be an 11 with Arcana.
All right, so... R2-D2.
Yep. Sorry about that.
No problem. So, you know, when you're playing with the crystals, you don't see anything going on the pedestal in front of you, but occasionally you catch a glimpse of a flicker of light along the walls.
Does it seem to, like, radiate through multiple crystals or any one particular crystal, like, at the corner of my eye? Like, each time I see it, I'm going to try and turn to see it. Does it seem to keep at the corner of the eye, or do I actually catch full sight of it?
So what you actually see is it, like, the crystal you're touching, it seems like certain crystals will light up in correspondence with what you touch on the pedestal.
Does the pedestal look like it can be turned, moved, or manipulated in any fashion? Can I start messing around with that?
It looks like it would tear the material at the base.
That could be a good thing.
As I'm watching him, I'll ask him, are you hearing sounds when those things light up?
Am I?
Yes.
It sounds like a musical instrument to me.
Would it be possible to use my awakened mind feature, the telepathy 30 feet, to include my companions who are not hearing this so that they can also hear? So, sort of like a relay?
Yes, I'll allow that. Absolutely. Yeah.
Then I begin doing that. I close my eyes for a minute and kind of sway my head sideways, kind of in a weird way, and all of a sudden you guys, I stop talking out loud, and the remainder of the session, my voice will be inside of your heads. But I share these sounds with you as well so that you can hear them.
So, Bert, as to your question, it does kind of sound like a musical instrument to you.
So, my guess is, or my thought is, if you play the right tones, since when you hit an odd one, it seems to be discordant, you're going to activate something. And since you have the experience with this sort of thing, I think you're the best candidate.
My crest on my head kind of falls a little bit. My shoulders droop. I'm going, oh, man, you got me underground. Now you want me messing with aliens. Okay. Do you guys want to...
Does anyone have any kind of tool proficiency or perform or tool proficiency that's an instrument?
No.
I have a calligraphy set.
I do not.
Okay, so basically, I will allow whoever wants to make the attempt to try and play the stones as an instrument using your charisma.
I'm very charismatic, though, so.
And, I guess that's it.
I'll ask you guys mentally, do you want to be in here when I try this, or do you want to move back to the outside door?
I think we need to support each other. If you're going to do this, we need to be on guard in case something untoward happens.
So okay. if they stay linked in with you and help you, I'll let you make the roll with advantage.
Roger that. So then stepping up to this... The thing that's manipulatable, I will attempt to first I'll use my claws to kind of break that stuff you said that was along the bottom, kind of holding it in place, cut that with my claws, and then afterwards I will attempt to make to move it and manipulate it, make music with it. That'll be a 19 with using my performance rather than or that's just basic charisma for me anyway, so.
Right. So when you do that, you basically are, you're able to key into a certain frequency and a rhythm and pattern, and with the help of your companions that are kind of like shaking their head yes or no when they feel like you've got it, the wall to the left parts almost like a curtain.
Well, that was weird.
And you can see there's another circular chamber with pods in there.
Oh no.
Base owners, let's kill them.
Are the pods on the roof or on the floor?
They're on the floor, and they're actually man-sized. They're bigger.
Hmm.
Invasion of the body snatchers. Let's kill them.
So this chamber is slightly smaller than the one you're in now. It's like 20 foot radius. It's circular in nature. Again, you're in here. You're not able to escape this stuff that's creeping all over the place.
Okay, being the defensive fighter, I will move first into the room.
Okay.
Do we have any way of attacking them from range instead of just going in and smacking them?
I'm pretty pretty. That's pretty much all I do is attack at range. I don't like to be up close and personal too often.
I have no way to attack at range. If I try to attack at range, I'm going to fail horribly.
Did you go to the entryway, Aaron, or did you wait when they spoke up?
I went to the entryway.
Okay. Well, you can see, now that you're a little bit closer, you can see a person's face poking out of one of these pods.
It's a bug hunt, guys.
I'm going to
make game over, man. Game over.
The psychic bondings tell them that there's some sort of human face in these things.
It's the thing. Let's kill it. No, for real. I'm walking in there. I got my torch.
Do it.
My axe in my right hand. Let's see what this sucker is.
Okay, so as you do that, and you get closer to one of the pods, the eyes pop open, and like wide with fright, and the person's jaw drops in like a silent scream, and it looks like a human, but you know this is all you can see. Everything else is totally like embedded in this. In this capsule.
Is it mouthing the words, pay no attention to the man inside the pod?
I think he's thinking about it.
Okay. Let's see if I can politely cut it open with my axe so that there's no spraying of things on me.
So there's like 7 of these pods in here, and you start doing that? And you're able to kind of like shave it away and, slowly so as to not injure the person. And eventually you get enough of it where he just kind of like falls out along with all of this, like, this fluid. It's almost like it would kind of remind you maybe like of, embryonic fluid that just comes rushing out of the pod and like kind of washes the person out into your arms, and they're just covered in this slime. And his eyes flutter for a moment, and he kind of like passes out.
Fancy meeting you here.
And then, as you clear him away, you can see that those black veins from the from inside the pod were actually going into him at different intervals in his arms and his legs. But he's completely free of them now, and he almost looks like track marks now, on him. He's pretty much naked, other than like a loincloth. Yeah, it is very kind of Matrix-like.
All right, so let's maybe start releasing a couple of these other guys. You said there are 7 total, right?
Yes. So you end up freeing. Go ahead.
While they're cutting these guys down and whatnot, I am not going to cut down any of these guys or aid in that. I'm going to continuously keep watch, seeing if anything tries to creep up on us or anything like that.
Okay. So all right. So you're standing guard. It takes you guys a little while, but with the 3 of you working, after 15, 20 minutes, you're actually able to get them all out. And there's 3 women and 4 men. And they look like people that were just snatched off the street the night before.
Are they conscious?
They're unconscious.
Do they look injured or
drained? The best way to describe them is they look drained. They're all very pale. They're showing signs of dehydration.
I will reach out my hand and touch one of them and extend my awakened mind and see if I can pull anything psychically. I know it's not the same thing as read thoughts or anything like that, but if there's any type of lingering, any type of mentalness that I could sense.
You actually It's like stepping into a nightmare when you do that. You believe that's exactly what you're seeing. Like it's like the person's dreaming, and you know in your mind you see this. You see the creature that is kind of serpentine-like in its body, except for it has a bunch of tiny legs along its base. It's bipedal in the sense that it's upright. At the same time, it's like sitting up on like almost like a snake's body, except for it's covered in that chitin. It's segmented. It's got four arms, two of which are much bigger and beefier. They actually end in sickle-like blades. Then it has a set of smaller arms with three fingers, and it looks like it would be able to manipulate things with it. The head is very bug-like with multiple eyes, six eyes in total, three and three, huge mandibles, large. It is kind of like a centipede tar. a large crest comes off the back of its head and kind of flares out. It looks kind of like an ankheg's head, only a little more distinct, and the chitin is more developed and more ornate looking.
When this vision is done, I minor illusion and say these guys are dreaming or something of this creature and show everybody this crazy looking.
Should we put them back?
They don't seem to be liking to dream about this. I think this is something that's being done to them rather than something that they are doing at the. Is my guess that these are victims. So putting them back, I don't know. We're not getting paid to save these people, but if we could save people, I would like to save them.
Defiant yeah, one's expression. Destroy them.
There is that.
I think that we should try. Give them water, something, try and wake them up. See if they can be woken up.
So if any of you have medicine, you want to try a medicine check, or if a cleric wants to try healing, or if anyone has a healing potion or something like that, you could try any of the above.
I got nothing. Anybody else?
I'm not trained, but I can attempt to do... everyone can always attempt to do some kind of first aid.
Yeah.
I will pull out my... water pouch and try and give them some water, wash some stuff off, and do my first aid bit as best I can.
With
a 10.
I'll try using the medicine kit and make a medicine check.
Okay.
Even better.
I rolled a 1, so I probably just killed my guy.
I got a non-natural 20.
Okay, so between the 10 and the 20, we'll say the 1 didn't actually kill anybody. But you're not able to revive them, but they are stable. You can see that they don't seem to be in danger at the moment. But they're probably going to need some recovery, some rest.
The one that revives, I'll ask him.
No, we didn't revive him.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought I misheard you. Never mind.
No, you are able to get him to take some of the water, and it seems like if continuous treatment like that for a day or so would probably bring them around. In addition to some medical attention.
Although it's not part of our mission, I think we need to take a few minutes and get these folks into the sunlight.
I look at the other two and say, "What's y'all's vote?"
I will agree with the take them into the sunlight, but I don't know what all is going down in here, and this stuff seems to be growing. Taking them out of here might be spreading some kind of contagion or whatever.
Yeah, well, we don't have to take them outside, just in the sunlight inside the warehouse. And it seems the sunlight has affected this stuff and made it inert before.
All right, you convinced me.
So it'll take you a little bit of work, but after 30 minutes or so, you know, you drag them all to the entry point, and then you know, one by one, you could probably, you know, either rope them up or Uncle Sam could fly them up and kind of lay them out in the sunlight. And when you do put them in the sunlight, they do regain a little bit of color, but they're not quite there yet.
I think it's the right thing to do.
Yeah, leave them there for a little while, flip them after like 25 minutes, metal rack. Go back down and see what else we can find.
So you can each take inspiration for rescuing the victims.
Awesome.
In our games, we just accumulate it and don't worry about.
Yep. Asking the rest of the party, I'll ask you guys, do you think maybe we should secure them before we leave? Like, tie them? I don't mean like to tie them up so they can't necessarily shamble away. I don't want them turning into those zombie-like things that were out here before. I don't know if that's something that they can do or not, but do you think it might be a good idea to secure them?
It's always a good idea to secure unknowns. Don't leave enemies at your back.
Yeah, you could probably even find things in the warehouse to use as well. Like,
let's put them in a crate and nail it shut.
Well, that kind of, what are we going to do, poke holes in it for the sunlight?
That does, but do you think that the prolonged exposure to the sunlight is going to aid them, or that the sunlight has already done its deed?
I have two answers. One is as me, the other is with my 8 intelligence character. Which one do you want to hear?
Absolutely, the 8 intelligence character.
Put them in box, use animal grease inside, leave top open, they cannot get out.
I'm okay with that. I don't have any animal grease, but...
What you can actually find in the warehouse itself is tarps. So you can cocoon, you know, individually you can cocoon them in tarps if you wanted to.
From one cocoon to another? Oh, we're so cruel.
Well, let's do that. Let's secure them so that we know that they won't be attacking us in the back if they somehow turn.
All right. I will supervise.
All right. So another hour or so goes by. You secure all 7 of them. You guys, you know, have probably been here now for, you know, 2.5-3 hours. It is midday. So you guys have, you know, a few hours of sunlight still left.
Okay. Let's move forward. We don't want to wait till dark.
No, the contract was to finish before dark. We need to hurry now.
Yeah, the more intelligent of the characters have already probably surmised that the sunlight is what is holding this stuff at bay and keeping it from spreading further.
Yes. Like I said, it would have been really useful for the daylight spell.
Except daylight spell doesn't actually create daylight. You need the sunlight spell to do that.
That's correct. Daylight's just an improved light spell.
Yeah. Good point.
You guys find yourself back in the obelisk chamber, and you've kind of figured out the controls after having used them once successfully, and you're able to get another curtain to open. And this one is much wider, and the hallway is 20 feet wide. You can see the tunnel extends about 40 feet into a huge chamber.
So you got that ambient glowing green light?
Everything does, yes.
Lead on, my metal-clad friend, and I tap him on the back.
And, you know, so in the distance, now you see a bunch of those, like, egg sacs on the ground, like, all over this chamber. They're not exactly the same as the ones that were attached to the ceiling, but they're very similar.
I torch them all as I'm walking.
You can actually start lighting them on fire. And they do catch. But in the, you know, in this, as you get into the chamber, there is actually other figures moving around, and it was those creatures that Uncle Sam had seen in the nightmares.
Creatures?
Creatures, yes. You see three of them. And, you know, from stem to stern, they if they were to lay down on the ground, they'd probably be 7-8 feet long, and fairly thick in their lower extremity. Which the only thing you can describe it as is like almost like a snake's tail, in the way it looks, and it's got a ton of these little legs coming off of it, again like a centipede. And as it goes up into the upper torso, it gets a bit more humanoid in shape. It's thicker, they're broader. Two of them look similar but different than the other one, in the sense that it seems to be more heavily armored in its chitin, and the colorations are slightly different. And again, they have those large Sith-like arms, and then they have the two lower arms, and then the heads have these huge crests that go way back. So the head itself is probably almost like from the tip of the mandibles to the edge of its crest is like 3 feet long, six dark black eyes staring out with inhuman intelligence. What are you guys doing?
Are we... under the impression, guys, these are the bad guys.
I think it's time to earn our pay, boys.
Yeah, there's at least going to be something here.
Are they all fairly close together?
They are. They're close together in a bit of a clearing where the eggs are not, and it almost seems like you've awoken them.
I'm going to initiate combat.
All right, drop some... well, actually, you guys can have this round and then give me initiative. So this round, do whatever you want, and then we're going to roll initiative.
Okay, I'm going for swings. Multiple swings.
Since I started it, can I do something before these guys charge in?
That's between you guys.
I'm fine with that.
I'm going to raise my hammer and feel the tempest of Thor. And I'm going to throw an ice storm right on these guys.
What are the dimensions of this room, Dave?
All right, so this room is... The ceiling is 20 feet from the ground, and the room itself is oblong. So it's about 30 feet wide. By about 60 feet long.
And that has, if I'm not mistaken, a constitution save.
Okay.
I did 12 bludgeoning damage and 16 cold damage.
All right, and what is your DC?
15.
And okay, you said that's a con save?
I think that is correct, yeah.
All right, so they actually are going to all fail their saving throw, it would appear. And you said, how much damage did you say? I'm sorry.
12 bludgeoning and okay. 16 cold.
All right.
How many of those eggs does that just splat?
Easily, you know, a dozen. Just gone.
Awesome. How many eggs appear to be remaining?
Easily three times that number.
Oh, crap.
If you had to guess, you've just found a nest chamber.
My turn?
Whoever wants to go, yep.
In between, centered, are all three of these nightmare creatures, are they all, like, adjacent to each other? Are they at three different locations in this large room? Or is there a way I can get them within a 20-foot area?
They are within a 20-foot area. There's three of them, and they're probably, you know, they're all within 15 foot of each other.
Reaching into my bag, I pull out a black squirming tentacle component, and I go ahead and cast a spell. It sounds pretty nightmarish to you guys, the words that I'm speaking as I'm casting it, and black tentacles, Ivard's black tentacles to be exact, pop up in those squares, trying to grab those dudes and smash them. And that'll be a DC 15 dex save, where they take... nine points of bludgeoning damage and are restrained.
Okay.
Nice.
What is the DC on that?
15.
Okay. All right, so they're all restrained.
And what you guys noticed, it looks like nasty black tentacles grow up out of the ground, start grabbing these guys and just slamming them into the ground while they take that 9 points. And that'll end my surprise round.
You want to go, Mr. Barbarian?
Yeah. I just rolled for my two axe attacks, a 16 and an 11. Either of them hit.
Are you entering the tentacles?
Unfortunately, I'm not an evoker, so they will grab at you too.
Since you say that, I just kind of wave my axe menacingly and go, yeah, take that. Okay, I guess we're not doing anything.
Nah, you smashed a couple eggs along the way.
Not a bad idea. I'll start poking a few of them with my torch.
All right, so Aaron, what are you doing?
Well, since there are tentacles there and they will grab at me, I think I will cast another Burning Hands at them.
Okay.
And that's 11 points of damage unless they make a DC 11 save.
Okay, so you'll be able to get two of them with that.
Okay.
And they will take the 11 points of damage.
Oh, they are restrained. Woohoo!
All right, so with that, you guys can roll initiative.
Thank you.
All right, so it looks like Alan is up.
I will maintain concentration on my Ivard's tentacles and target two separate of them with Eldritch Blasts. The first will hit at a 25 DC, or AC, and the second at a 26. I'm rolling fire right now.
And they will absolutely hit.
I choose not to move them, however. First Eldritch Blast is 12 points of damage. Second one is 9 points of damage.
Alright, so their heads explode. A spray of ichor.
If that happens, then I change my mind about maintaining that concentration. Go ahead and drop it for my allies. When you say their heads explode, I assume that means they're dead, right?
Well, unless they can keep acting without a head. I'm not completely ruling it out, but yeah, it seems like they're down.
I don't know that. Seeing that two of them died like that, I will drop concentration on the tentacles so that my melee allies can get up in there.
Excellent. All right, so that would bring us to the 15.
Okay, so me. So seeing that the tentacles are gone, I am going to approach the last remaining target so far.
Okay.
And I say that with skepticism. And I will swing my silver sword at him.
Okay.
With an 18 attack.
All right. So as you go to do that, a shape drops from the ceiling. And it looks much like the two that were just dispatched, only its chin and its crest is much more ornate, and it's actually much larger than the other ones. And its mouth and sides flash out as you're moving in to make your attack.
Okay.
Okay, so a 17 is probably going to miss you.
Yep. Well, yeah. I have a 21 AC, so.
Yeah. So it goes for a bite on you and completely misses. And then comes in with the claws for AC 18, which scrabbles against your metal plating. And does not find purchase. You just hear the horrible screeching sound in your ears as it slides along the metal plates. And now you're free to act.
Okay. Taking into the account that the thing that just dropped out of the ceiling, I'm going to change my target from the one that was stuck in the middle to the one that's attacking me and swing at it with the 18.
Okay. okay, so 18 will hit.
Okay. That takes 14 points of damage. And then I will extra attack with a nat 20.
That will hit.
That's 16 points of more damage.
Okay. It screeches at you. And hisses in your face as you slam at it with. What are you fighting with?
A long sword.
Okay, create slashes in its chin with your long sword. And all right, so the one creature that has just recently been freed from. From the tentacles, looks at the lot of you and hisses, and shuffles to the side a little bit, and throws its head forward and its mandibles open wide, and it just vomits out a 30-foot line of acid. catching the barbarian and the warrior. Give me dex saves.
Oh, I saved that one.
That sounds like a high roll.
20, crit.
I actually got an 18 total.
Okay, so you both will pass your saving throw and take half damage. So 14 points of acid damage and save for half, so only 7.
Man, I should have taken protection from acid.
Protection from elements is an awesome spell.
Well, I can only choose from attack spells and...
It's abjuration.
Yeah. Oh, is it?
Yeah, it's a really cool one for Eldritch Knights.
Oh.
So that brings us to... I saw...
I think it's me.
A 12?
Yep.
Yeah.
I am going to cast Guiding Bolt at the acid spitting guy. 16 points of damage.
What AC did you hit?
Well, spell attack bonus 26.
Oh yeah. Totally nailed him.
And the next attack against him is at advantage due to the glow of the radiant damage.
I don't think that's going to be necessary as your guiding bolt pierces right through his chest and blows out the back of him.
Nice.
It falls over.
Don't spit on me.
Who we got? We got an 8.
You're saying for initiative, gotcha.
Yeah.
So, what, the main dude that just spit acid on his side?
Yeah, he just blasted a hole right through his chest.
What a bitch! Watch, that wasn't his final form, right? Okay, so it's just that other one?
Yes, the big one that dropped down.
He's going to walk over, saunter over there and take two axe swings at him. I get a modified 20 and then a 25 to hit.
Absolutely.
Okay. 26 damage total.
Okay, so it absolutely hisses in rage at you as you nearly cave in its side.
Nearly? It's still standing?
It is still standing.
Nah, whatever.
Did everybody go already?
Yep.
Oh yeah. Okay. So, it's turns and it's looking, at each of you. And you can just see the malice and rage coming off of it, as it's weighing its options. It's currently engaged with two of you, and after trying to attack. The walking tank. It kind of has given up of that and turns towards the half orc and bites at you for AC 20.
Okay, yeah. I'm going to reaction and impose disadvantage on him due to protection.
Oh, this guy.
Ooh, okay. So
anybody named after the coolest Green Lantern, you got to be cool.
Okay, so that is now an 11, so I think that's going to miss. So is it disadvantage on all the attacks or just the next attack?
Just the next attack it makes with okay. It within 5 feet of me of attacking someone else.
Okay, and it crit fails. So it's so distraught over you throwing its shield in its way. When it went after him with the claws, it just starts gnawing on your shield. But as a consolation prize to my monster, it totally pitted your shield with the acid.
Dang! I'm going to have to get a new shield. Well, it's better to be pitted a shield than someone else.
All right, so top of the order for you guys.
22.
So is this thing on the ground now? It came down off of the ceiling, or is it like big enough? And it's...
It came off of the ceiling. It dropped down.
All right, with a mean look in my eye, I will scream, "Get away from them, you bitch!" and cast another couple of Eldritch Blasts at it. I'm assuming that an 8 will miss, but a 21 should hit.
It does.
And that'll be for 13 points of damage, and it's thrown back 10 feet. Do they get attacks of opportunities as it leaves their threatening range?
No, not when it's moved, only if they choose to move.
All right, cool.
And that was it. What was the total, 13?
13.
Okay.
Force, and that was like a sickly green ether laser.
Yeah, you take a huge chunk out of his side, and it's looking really bad.
Okay.
Yep.
So, it's only 10 feet away from me, so I am going to move up and swing at it twice with my sword. 20 and 11. So, 20 hits, I take it.
Oh, yeah, 20 absolutely hits. The 11 does not, though. So, sorry, something funny in the chat just caught my eye.
14 points of damage.
All right. So, as you move in, you actually just step up and with one slice just send its head flying. As the momentum from your swing spins the whole body, and that's where you can see that hanging from leather thongs attached to its back is actually the thing you were looking for.
All right. From leather thongs, okay. So, I am going to look at the warlock and go, is this thing safe to touch? Since it seems to be dealing with dark magic?
I have no idea. Why don't you touch it and we'll find out together? or if you'd like, I can send my homunculus to grab it. That way, I can always fix him if he gets hurt.
I'd rather not be taken over by whatever this thing was taken over by. Whatever this thing is.
Let's let little homie here grab it.
Homie the homunculus.
Yeah.
Nice. So he picks it up without any problems and is able to safely bring it to you. You guys have that box to put it in.
I have the chest. I'll open that up.
And as it falls in and you shut it, there's you hear this mental chime.
Kind of look around. Tim? Tim? Where's Tim?
And with that, if you guys want to wrap up the rest of the eggs with torches or spells, you can do that easy enough. Nothing else pops out or messes with you guys.
Yep, clear the egg.
Definitely. Casting bonfire everywhere.
I do it. So each time I poke one,
and then, so with that, you're able to take the chest, and this is all cleared out. And actually, as you're leaving, the substance is already beginning to flake off the walls and start to dissolve. It seems like putting the crystal into the box itself is cutting it off from its source of power energy.
You have now, guys. Go ahead.
you have all those crystals that are kind of just laying on the ground. They've all kind of fallen out of that chamber you guys were in on the floor now as well.
Well, take those as extra loot.
Definitely.
It might be worth something somewhere.
While we're picking these up, I'll say, what do we do with these survivors? They did say they wanted this quiet, discreet, and didn't want them, right? So do we tell them, or what do you guys think?
No, what we do is we find a relatively safe alley and leave them in it.
I think that sounds like some of the nights I've had in my youth.
No.
Couple different protocols.
We're not killing people. We're not leaving them in an alley. They need medical attention. If you want, we can bring them to a church, a temple of some sort.
Is there a church in this town?
There is. The center of town, there's a very large, I guess you would call it a non-denominational church of the light, where all the, all the different goodly gods are kind of revered there.
Before we actually take them anywhere, though, I do want to touch on them again and see if they're still in that nightmare realm, dreaming of the creature, or if they're not.
They actually seem a lot more peaceful now. And now that you touch them again, you actually feel like you didn't realize it before, but now that it's absent, you realize there was a presence upon them, and you know, it could have something to do with those creatures or the crystal or the fact that they've been exposed to sunlight for a while now.
Okay, we're going to transport them to the local Shrine of Goodness.
Okay, so when you go outside, you're in a warehouse district, so you could probably find like a porter with a wagon or something and have them and load them up into the wagon and take them there to the church without any problems. When you get them to the church, you're met by the priest there, Father Frelier, who takes them all in and promises to take care of them and do what he can for them.
We'll just explain to him that we found them trapped and wanted to ensure that they were taken care of.
Well, I appreciate your good citizenship, sir.
More than that, I'm just going to fill them in a little bit for future adventurers to know what's coming, maybe, that there were some parasites unidentified on them. So whatever kind of spells you have that could get rid of that, please. And I'll make a donation of 50 gold, 70 gold, one for each of them, 10 for each of them.
Oh, it's most gracious. I appreciate it so much. And the priest appears to be in his late 20s, early 30s, blonde, sandy blonde hair, blue eyes. A little out of shape, but looks like a kind person, and seems genuinely very grateful for your donation.
Well, that's the young priest. Now we need the old priest. These things might be possessed.
Yeah. Yeah, I stay quiet during this whole thing because I know they paid for discretion, so I don't necessarily want to break that discretion. Just say these are some sick people. That there might be some kind of outsider presence here. You might want to look into and leave it at that.
Okay, we will definitely look after them, do our best to make sure that they're okay and not of a danger to anyone else. With that, he calls for some of the other priests and acolytes to take them to a separate wing of the church where they're going to be housed by themselves.
I'm just going to nod him and say Thor's blessing on you.
He smiles and nods back. Thank you.
Gentlemen,
one can never have too many blessings.
Isn't that the truth? I think we have an appointment, gentlemen.
We do.
Yep.
So
you should disclose this, that there were survivors and where we dropped them off, or at least that we did drop them off someplace.
PC when we're about input. A block. Go ahead.
Looks like PC input.
When we're about a block away from that temple, I'll pull out my homie, the homunculus, and send him back with private instructions to keep watch on those seven people. Not to interfere with anything that happens and to keep me informed to get in contact with me should anything happen, whether people come for them or people come out of them.
Okay. So I imagine you tend to place to find you.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
We've got that tight knit bond. He can communicate with me as long as he's within a mile telepathically. So.
Okay, you're having him watch over the people.
Yeah. Watch, but only watch. Don't expose yourself. Don't be seen.
Okay.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And then,
gotcha.
and then continue on to this meeting with our employer.
Okay. Well, as soon as you arrive, again the bell chimes as you go through the door, and the halfling secretary waves you right on through. And as you guys are walking down the hall, the last rays of sunlight are cascading behind you through the open window. And once again the door opens automatically for you, and Jacob is sitting at his customary spot, and he is beaming from ear to ear as he sees the four of you enter his chamber. Greeting, gentlemen. I hope you have good news for me.
As for your warehouse, it was taken care of.
Excellent.
Sorry, your men did not make it.
That is most unfortunate. I will see that their families are compensated and taken care of. It grieves me much to lose my employees like this. Those men have worked for me for many years.
I'll set the box on his desk.
So, he asked for a full report of everything that happened because he's not quite sure. And, he asked a couple, pointed questions here and there as you guys are going through it. Do you tell him about the survivors?
I do not volunteer that information, but I don't know what the rest of the party will do. But I'm definitely, as we're doing the rendition of the story of what's going on, I'm using my minor illusion to augmented, showing off these horrible creatures and the egg sacs and what it looked like.
Yeah, at many points he cringes and makes facial expressions and sounds of disgust when you show the imagery and tell the story. Clearly, he has much disdain for these creatures and the whole affair in itself. And every once in a while, he'll tisk and make noises. You could just tell that he's going through these mental gymnastics and calculations of figuring, damages, what this is going to cost, and how much it could possibly hurt his reputation. And when you conclude the story, he pulls out, four sacks of gold and putting them each in front of you. The agreed upon amount is in there. And and when you open, if you open the pouches and check, it's actually platinum instead of gold. Wow. Just because it's easier to transport.
Wow. I am going to volunteer the information though, without actually telling him where they are, just in a local church, because he does need to know this. The main guys do need to know this stuff.
Okay, so he's probably going to figure out where, because this is not a very pious city, and there are not many churches, especially good ones here. This is kind of like our version of Sin City. What other places might call black market is just their market.
just the market. I like that.
So, I appreciate that, and I will also check in and make sure there is no further problems, and I will compensate them for their inconvenience. It sounds like quite the horrible experience they've gone through.
So this is a good guy. Cool. Because if not, Thump will be there.
And, unsavory acts are bad for business. I'm an honest businessman. So with that concludes our session for this evening, and I wanted to get it done in time for the reshowing of Game of Thrones. So, after our schedule's like, curses!
As we exit the building, I take off in a little flock of feathers and say, I'm in the pipe, 5x5. Fly off into the sunset.
So, I want to thank everyone who watched. I want to thank you guys for playing. And I want to thank especially Alan for showing up, for jumping in at the last minute. We lost a player. We're not sure what happened there. I think you might have had some technical difficulties. So, with that, until next time, everybody, stay nerdy.
Stay nerdy.
Thanks, guys. Stay nerdy.